Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedical School, and today we're going to talk about the growing epidemic of Clostridium difficile infections. Let's begin by understanding what is C. difficile. C. difficile is an anaerobic bacterium that produces toxins which lead to profuse diarrhea. There are different strains of C. difficile, and these include a hypervirulent and non-hypervirulent strains. The problem with C. difficile is that if spores form, they can contaminate many surfaces and survive in these surfaces for long periods of time. These long-lasting spores then place others at risk. General disinfectants cannot kill C. diff spores and really requires high concentration bleach products to effectively clean areas covered by C. difficile. Now, C. diff infections can be divided into community, hospital-acquired, or indeterminate based on the likely setting a patient contracted C. diff. A community infection is defined if the symptoms of infection begin in the community setting or within 48 hours of entering the healthcare setting. Hospital-acquired C. diff infections are defined if the settings begin after 48 hours in the hospital or less than 4 weeks after leaving the hospital. Finally, an indeterminate infection is if symptoms begin in the community setting 4 to 12 weeks after leaving the healthcare setting. Now, what places people at risk for C. diff infections? Advanced age, hospitalizations, antibiotic exposure, history of GI surgery or procedures. Interestingly, some studies have indicated antidepressants such as fluoxetine and mirtazapine may increase risk of C. diff infections. In addition, low albumin levels, immunosuppression, PPIs, and a history of IBD or irritable bowel disease may predispose a person to C. diff infections. Of note, the data regarding PPIs is weak, but the FDA has listed it as a risk of PPI use. The severity of C. diff infection is dictated by risk factors and by the type of strain that causes the infection. So what makes the hypervirulent strain so infectious? Well, normally, there are genes that allow C. diff to produce toxins. A gene called the TCDC repressor gene partially represses the toxin-producing gene. But in the hypervirulent strain, the repressor gene is non-functional, allowing a large production of toxin A and B, leading to a more profound infection. Hypervirulent strains are associated with increased recurrence, severity, and mortality. Now that we've talked about the strains of C. diff, let's talk about how to diagnose C. diff. There are multiple tests that can be used. The first we'll talk about is a stool culture. Stool cultures are the standard for diagnosis of C. diff because they have high specificity and sensitivity, but these cultures take too long to be clinically useful. In addition, we could obtain a PCR for C. diff toxin. This requires a lab with specially trained techs, but more importantly, we cannot differentiate between colonization from actual active infection, making this test less clinically useful. Stool cytotoxin assay does identify the toxin produced by C. diff in the stool. It is the most widely used test to identify an active C. diff infection because of its high detection rate for active infections and fast turnaround time. Finally, the enzyme immunoassay can be used as it has moderate specificity and sensitivity, but given there are other more sensitive and specific tests, we generally use this test very infrequently. Imaging studies can help identify the complications of C. diff. Now, colonoscopies are not routinely done during C. diff infection, and actually they should be avoided due to a high risk of perforation because of the severe inflammation. If a colonoscopy is done, you may see pseudomembranes, but these are not specific to C. diff infections. In addition, CAT scans and x-rays can help identify complications such as colonic wall thickening or toxic megacolon. Megacolon is when the colon dilates so greatly there's a high risk of perforation, and it is a surgical emergency. The factors that identify severe C. diff are important to know. These include leukocytosis 15,000 or greater, serum creatinine 1.5 times or greater than baseline, hypotension, shock, ileus, perforation, and megacolon. If a patient has these signs, these are an indication the patient has high risk for severe C. diff infection, more likely caused by the hypervirulent strain. Now let's talk about treatment. Treatment of C. diff largely depends on if someone has a history of C. diff and the severity of their actual infection. For a first occurrence that is mild to moderate, you can treat with metronidazole 500 mg PO TID times 10 to 14 days. If a patient's first occurrence is severe, then use vancomycin 125 mg PO QID times 14 days plus IV metronidazole. TID is 3 times a day, QID is 4 times a day. For the first recurrence, if the infection is mild to moderate, we can use metronidazole 500 milligrams PO, that's orally, TID times 14 days. But if a severe recurrence occurs, then we must use vancomycin 125 milligrams PO QID times 14 days with IV metronidazole. For the second recurrence, we treat differently, usually with a vancomycin taper as listed here. For any further recurrences, consider vancomycin followed by rifaximin 400 milligrams BID or twice a day for 14 days. Now, a new drug has been developed called fidaxomicin. This drug has been shown to be as effective as vancomycin if given for at least 10 days. Of note, fewer recurrences occurred after treatment with fidaxomicin than vancomycin, but this advantage was only noted in non-hypervirulent strains. In addition to fidaxomicin, fecal transplants have been shown to improve outcomes by restoring gut flora, and this is really an active area of research. In addition, there are current investigations into the use of IV immunoglobulins for treatment of C. diff, and also probiotics have been kind of used to help treat C. diff, but really there's no data to support their use. Well, that was a brief review of C. diff infections. I hope you liked it. If you did, share this video on Facebook and Twitter. You can follow us on Facebook, just search for iMedical School on the Facebook pages, or Twitter at iMedSchool. Make sure to like this video, place a question or comment down below, and subscribe. Finally, check out our podcast out on iTunes. And this is Dr. K. I'll see you next time.